In the last year and a half, all of this has filled in. People are saying this up here could be worth tens of billions of dollars. In 2004, you could have had any one of those concessions. This happened overnight.
Since 2009, for the last 3 years, the US oil and gas industry and its supporters and lobbyists in the US government have been working to shape policy and public opinion in Poland ahead of the US plan to exploit Poland's shale gas reserves. Three conferences in 2010 and 2011 prepared the way. These invitation-only conferences were sponsored by the oil industry and brought together US and Polish politicians, lobbyists, oil and gas companies, and public relations companies. The first conference was in April 2010 in Warsaw. The second conference was in Warsaw on May 18th, 2011, and the third conference was at the end of May 2011, also in Warsaw. These meetings were supported by a series of US-Polish bilateral meetings between American and Polish politicians and policymakers between the years of 2009 and 2011. The message sent out from these meetings was that Poland will become the first country outside America to have a large-scale shale gas industry, which will strengthen US-Polish relations. US oil companies will bring their new brute force fracking technology to liberate Polish gas supplies and bring energy independence, jobs, and government revenue to Poland. This is the public relations message. The reality is very different. This report is based on information freely available in the public domain, and the information is drawn primarily from the oil and gas industry itself. Why Poland? The gas industry estimates that Europe has 15 trillion cubic meters of shale gas reserves. One third of this gas is in France. Another third of the reserves is spread across the UK, Sweden, Norway, Denmark, Germany, Austria, Hungary, and Bulgaria. The French government has put a temporary ban on exploration until it conducts environmental impact studies. The UK has temporarily halted exploration after the first company to drill, called Quadrilla, caused earthquakes last year. Public opposition to Shell's shale gas project in Sweden forced the company to abandon its plans last year. And recently, the Bulgarian government banned the fracking industry. That leaves Poland, which has one third of the reserves and seems to offer the path of least resistance to the oil companies. 3 years of lobbying have paid results.
Z gazem łupkowym w Polsce wszyscy wiążą olbrzymie nadzieje. Czekamy jak młodzi chłopcy na dziewczynę.
It's the cost benefit of BS, of PR, of ads, and payoffs to politicians is extraordinary. The return on investment of paying off a politician, running an ad, discrediting critics, it's one of the best investments that the industry can make.
Ladies and gentlemen, Polish government fully supports activities in shale gas sector. Some companies and experts start talking about Poland being potentially a new gas exporter. And who would have seen that coming 10 or even 5 years ago?
These companies: ExxonMobil, Marathon, Chevron, ConocoPhillips, Total of France, Eni, and Shell, among others. Here are the fiscal terms that the oil companies have obtained in Poland. The royalties on production in Poland are from 1% to 2.5%. In the USA, royalties on production are from 18% to 25%. The corporate tax rate in Poland is 19%. In USA, 35 to 40%. The oil and gas companies also like the concession prices being offered by Poland. Here's a quote from the April 2010 Warsaw Conference from Wolf Regener, who's the chief executive officer of BNK Petroleum. BNK Petroleum hold a number of the concessions in Poland. "We were actually really surprised by how inexpensive the acreage was. In the United States, unproven acreage costs $100 to $200 per acre. And top quality property can run all the way up to $30,000 per acre. Decent shale plays usually run at least $8,000 per acre. What we found is that in Europe, the most expensive acreage we were pursuing was 55 cents per acre. Polish acreage, on the other hand, can be leased at rates that stand at between 3 cents and 25 cents per acre." The oil and gas companies are also attracted to countries that have a lack of regulation.
"We see here containers with very corrosive, very poisonous chemicals. Obviously, these chemicals are supposed to be added to water in the process of fracking."
"No environmental impact assessment was required here," Marek says.
"Chemicals are pumped into the ground, and we are not interested what is the environmental impact of these poisonous chemicals. I don't think it's right."
State protection. The oil and gas companies prefer to operate where the government assures their protection against protests, which have stopped fracking in many countries. That will not happen in Poland, according to Vice Minister for the Environment, Bernard Błaszczyk. "Polish authorities will do everything to make sure that no protests are able to stop shale gas exploration. This is the official position of the Polish government on the fracking industry." What is fracking? Fracking is short for brute force hydraulic fracturing, a new technology developed in the USA over the last 5 years to extract gas from deep shale rock formations. The latest form of fracking combines four technologies: lateral drilling, high volume fluid injection, slick water fracking fluid, and multiple well clusters. The fracking company drills a well to 3 or 4 kilometers underground and then turns the drill laterally into the shale formation. The well is then sealed with concrete. Most problems come from the concrete seal job. The company then sets off explosives from inside the well, fracturing the surrounding shale rock. The company then mixes millions of liters of fresh water with thousands of liters of chemicals and sand. This mixture is called fracking fluid. A series of interlinked diesel engines running around the clock drive millions of liters of fracking fluid into the well at enormous pressures of 600 atmospheres. To get an idea of what 600 atmospheres feels like, a truck tire is pressurized to about 2 atmospheres. The hydraulically pressurized fracking fluid further cracks the rocks and fills the cracks with sand, allowing the gas to start to escape. When the well tests positively, the operation is gradually expanded to more wells. Conventional gas drilling uses one rig to extract the gas from a field. Shale gas is spread over huge distances in a thin layer of rock, so unconventional gas drilling is done by using thousands of wells for each field, meaning one well for every 2.5 square kilometers. The industry plans to drill tens of thousands of wells in Poland. Each well requires several million liters of fracking fluid for each operation, and each well can be fracked several times. That means countless millions of liters of toxic chemicals being pumped into the ground all around the country. Here is a list, for example, of the chemicals that ExxonMobil put into its first well in the Lublin Basin, about 5 kilometers from the river Wisła, like these aromatic ketones, claiming that the formulas are industrial secrets. The question is, what happens to the billions of gallons of chemical fracking fluid that is sent down into these wells? One answer comes from Mike Eberhardt, a representative of drilling company Halliburton. According to Eberhardt, 20 to 60% of the fracking fluid can be recovered and disposed of. The rest, so between 40 to 60%, becomes geological water. Others call this pollution. Does this fracking fluid, which should not be in the human environment, stay underground and never come into contact with groundwater? The evidence so far is that the fracking fluid, or the methane gas, can migrate from the well into the groundwater. In the US, the documentary Gasland showed several cases where gas had escaped from wells and poisoned the groundwater, or where fracking fluid had contaminated the groundwater.
I told them that I wasn't happy, that our water was good before they started drilling, and when they got done, it was bad. We said, ask if we could prove that it was because of them. And my wife asked the guy if he could prove that it wasn't. He wouldn't talk to her anymore. We lived here 40 years and the water never had a problem with the water. And they drilled. After they drilled, the water was bad.
Asked about Gaslands, San Leon's John Bugenhagen dismissed the documentary's findings as,
I think it's bullshit.
So, you know, people are acting like once we break this rock, we've opened up thousands of meters of rock, where in reality, we've only fractured, you know, hundreds of meters of rock. And at 3,000 meters depth, you know, I still struggle with how that's all going to come to the surface here.
In fact, the gas industry knows exactly how it happens. Well failure. The escape of gas and fluids from wells is a well-known and chronic problem within the industry. Here's a statement from a conference of the Well Bore Integrity Committee in 2006. The committee is made up of the oil and gas companies. There is clearly a problem with well bore integrity in existing oil and gas production wells worldwide. Sealing 8 kilometers of drill well with cement is a difficult process. When gas wells are being drilled, they typically pass through groundwater and intermediate shales during the drilling process. Many things can cause well failure. Here are three of them. First, when the liquid concrete is being pumped, it goes through other shales that also have gas pressure. The gas, under high pressure, can move the liquid concrete out of the way and form channels up through the concrete into the open space. Second, the casing of steel pipe is under huge pressure. Steel corrodes, and joints can fail over time. The failure of the casing lets gas out into the well, where it can escape into groundwater where there's no concrete seal. Third, the chemistry of the concrete can be wrong. and the cement can set somewhere along the length before it reaches the surface, once again allowing gas to escape. These things cause the loss of wellbore integrity, or in simpler terms, well failure. Here is an example from an industry report on this problem. This photograph shows how the cement has failed to bond with the casing. When gas is freed underground, it typically has to pass up through groundwater to get to the surface. This chart of industry statistics show that brand new wells fail at a rate of 5%. Within 20 years, 60% of all wells fail. The projected lifespan of most of these fields in Poland is 30 years. To summarize, we know from industry figures that well failure is a chronic problem. We also know that thousands of liters of toxic chemicals are pumped into the ground through these wells. This leaves some questions. Where does the water for the fracking fluid come from? Where does it go to? Here are some of the problems faced by the industry in Poland. Lack of land, water, and not enough roads for the heavy traffic to transport equipment, water, and chemicals. Much of the population works in agriculture, and the country is densely populated. Industry insiders have warned investors that the lack of available water in Poland could be a problem. For example, from Bernstein Research in London last year, development of shale gas in Poland will be held back by a lack of land and water. From Stanislav Ryszlicki, PGNiG, the national Polish company. Access to water supplies will be a problem for investors. However, under the fracking contracts, the state must supply the water for free. Trucking all this fresh water, chemicals, and wastewater to the drill sites is going to be a problem. Jakub Kostecki, chief of New Gas Contracting, told a conference in Krakow that a lot of traffic is needed to get the seismic, drilling, and fracking equipment onto a given piece of property. We're talking about a lot of land and a lot of wells. The road tonnage capacity is way too low. One way around this problem is to site the wells as close as possible to water supplies. At the Warsaw conference, Halliburton reassured investors that access to water would be no problem. We take water from rivers, lakes, and various other resources that are available. As you can see from these photographs, the oil and gas companies have been able to site some of the first drilling wells in Poland right next to rivers, lakes, and reservoirs. Remember, 1 in 20 wells fail in the first year. A single accident can allow fracking fluid or gas into the water supply. Poland is 300,000 square kilometers. The watershed of Poland's main river is almost 200,000 square kilometers, more than half the country. The water system is connected. Although Poland is the first EU country to experiment with fracking, it is possible to make a comparison or guess what's going to happen here by looking at the Marcellus Shale. In the USA, the Marcellus Shale Basin stretches across New York, Pennsylvania, West Virginia. The Marcellus Shale is estimated to contain about 5 trillion cubic meters of gas, which is the same as the projected reserves in Poland. As the Marcellus Shale gas is the same size as the Polish shale, it's possible to foresee what's ahead for Poland if the planned development goes ahead.
fact is that Pennsylvania is 3 years into a 30-year large-scale industrial development. There are fewer than 2,000 Marcellus wells in Pennsylvania right now, but they're drilling them at the rate of 4 to 5 per day, and the rate at which they're being drilled is increasing. The industry intends to drill between 3,000 and 5,000 wells per year for the next 30 years in Pennsylvania, and if they get their way, in New York. Once the chemicals are injected and the fracturing process is complete, a large percentage of that fluid comes back up. So we have purposely polluted large quantities of fresh water with chemicals that do not belong in the human environment.
As other countries ban fracking, Poland becomes more and more important to the industry.
3, 2, 1, and liftoff.
How can the Polish government allow this to happen? Let's talk about the space shuttle syndrome. The US engineer, Richard Kuprowitz, warned that many development projects show signs of space shuttle syndrome. This is the rush to launch a project at all costs while downplaying or ignoring the risks. The impression of huge potential reward with little or no liability for poor decisions can cause even the brightest of organizations to make very unwise decisions.
Obviously a major malfunction.
He also points to an attitude of the industry known as third worlding. In this context, third worlding means to unwisely allow use of land for purposes that, in all probability, will result in severe loss of life. However, the country's governments place so little real value on such loss that corporations, or for that matter, governments, are willing to take the risk of massive catastrophic failure, usually for perceived short-term gain. Protests by local communities in the UK, France, Bulgaria and Sweden forced the governments to put a halt to fracking. In Poland, the same thing is starting to happen. A group of citizens halted the 2011 Warsaw Conference to deliver the message that fracking companies were not welcome in Poland. People in Poland have started to organize themselves against the gas companies, blocking roads carrying fracking equipment, and organizing locally to share knowledge about the fracking industry, and the reasons that people in many different countries have refused to allow their governments to impose the industry on their land. Unless the government listens to the local communities, Poland is headed for years of confrontation that will divide communities and set the people against the government.
I'm really concerned about people in Europe, India, Asia, Africa, that they're going to jump into this again too soon without understanding completely what the implications of this use of technology are on environment and human health.